Welcome back to Inland Empire Live. I'm Dennis, along with the ever so lovely and talented Laura Paredes. Laura, good to have you here.
Hi, Dennis.
You know what? Video games, it's a big business right now. As a matter of fact, it's so big, one of the most exciting events is coming to Cal State San Bernardino at the end of this month on the 29th of October. And joining us live is the man behind it all. He's the CEO of Mystical Stone Entertainment, a musician who learned by ear, and we'll talk to him about that and how he got involved in the video game industry a little over 20 years ago, Tommy Tallarico. Tommy, welcome to the show.
Hey, thanks for having me.
Stone, Mystical Stone Entertainment. Why that name?
It was cool.
It is.
Stonehenge, we thought it was kind of neat. Right, I don't know. Right. Everything else was taken.
Let's talk music and video games, then we'll get into the upcoming event that's coming to our city at the end of this month. How did you make that transition from being, you were a musician, or mm-hmm. are a musician and mm-hmm. composer,
yeah.
and actually you've won so many darn awards that we'd have to have a Penske truck back up to the back of this building to bring them in, but over 45, correct?
Yeah. I always was interested in music. My parents were a product of the 50s, so
yeah.
when I was 3 and 4 years old, we had a piano in the house, so I wanted to impress mom and dad, so I'd be banging out Great Balls of Fire and Jailhouse Rock on
cool.
the piano for my parents. And I have a very famous family member who's in rock and roll and this and that, so I always kind of grew up listening to rock music. And then in 1977, I heard the music to Star Wars. I went to see Star Wars. I was 10 years old at the time.
Yeah.
And heard this music from John Williams. And that was really the first time I ever, paid attention to, a symphony. I'm like, wow, what's mm-hmm. that, you know? Mm-hmm. And then back then, of course, we didn't have the internet, so I would go down to the library and I'd look for interviews and magazines and things about this John Williams guy. And I remember reading an interview and he was talking about, Beethoven and Mozart, and I'm like, mm-hmm. So, when I was around 10, 11 years old, I kind of, sought out Beethoven's music to, on my own. And when I think it makes a big difference than kind of having it pushed on you. And
sure,
so when
sure.
I heard Beethoven for the first time, really for the first time, when I was 10, 11, that really changed my life. And I said, wow, this is what I want to do. I want to, create music for symphonies,
Great.
But I still got the rock and roll background as well, so I kind of combined the two.
Great. So we fast forward to 1990,
mm-hmm.
and you start this this idea of video games. You came to California. Tell us the story how you came to California.
Yeah, well, I grew up in Springfield, Massachusetts on the East Coast, mm-hmm. and when I turned 21, I left my parents crying on the doorstep. And big Italian family, so it was a
I'm
big
going
deal.
To find fame and fortune.
I'm going to California,
right.
and I drove out there just by myself. I had no money, no job, no place to stay, no friends, nothing. I just got in the car and drove.
But you had a dream.
Now you know why my parents were crying. Yes, but I had a dream.
Right.
And that was it. Yeah. And the only place I really knew in California was Hollywood and Disneyland. So mm-hmm. I said, well, let me go to Disneyland, Orange County,
Sure.
And I picked up a newspaper the first day I was out here, and I saw a job for selling keyboards at a guitar center.
Right.
And I said, well, geez, I can maybe, con my way into that job, East Coast Italian thing,
Yeah.
And they said, yeah, okay, you start tomorrow. So, and I was homeless. I was actually living under a pier at Huntington Beach.
Wow.
For about the first 3 weeks I was in California.
Amazing.
But that first day of work at Guitar Center, I happened to wear, I had three t-shirts I brought with me, and one of them was a video game t-shirt, which back in 1990, nobody had video game t-shirts. Yeah. It's not like now, you can go to Hot Topic, you can go everywhere, you'll see video game t-shirts. Back then it was a rare thing.
It's like you were the oddball.
That was the oddball, and the very first person who walked in the store was a producer who worked for Richard Branson's Virgin Companies,
sure.
and they were starting a video game company right down the street, and he saw my t-shirt, and he said, hey, we're starting a company down the street, do you want to get paid to play video games? And I'm like,
there you go.
I'm like, boy, this California place is okay.
So yeah.
I was in California.
It really is where dreams come true.
I was in California 3 days, and I was in the video game industry, and that was over 22 years ago.
And you've been in it ever since.
Ever since,
and
yeah.
so you melded the music that you knew how to play, how
right.
to compose, with the video games. How did that come about?
Yeah, the one thing about video game music, when I first got in the industry, the technology wasn't really there. So it was a bunch of bleeps and bloops.
Right,
and so a lot of music back then was doot, doot, doot,
Right, simple stuff.
Sure. Because of the technology, sure. And I kind of wanted to change all that. I wanted to, I worked a lot on making the technology, better so that the music could be better. And mm-hmm. then in the, mid-90s, 93, 94, we got CD-ROMs as storage mediums now for games. So instead of trying to fit everything on a little tiny cartridge space, mm-hmm. Now we could start recording live guitar and drums and live orchestras and things like that. So video game music really started to change in the mid to late 90s. But even before that, my approach to video game music was, it doesn't have to be, like a merry-go-round. It doesn't have to sound like that.
And it doesn't have to sound like a loop over and over.
The very first video game I worked on, I did the music for, was the original Prince of Persia.
Wow.
And so that was the game we were designing. And again, instead of giving every level a do-do-do-do-do, I said, let's not do any music.
Right.
But let's only do music when he drinks a potion or when he pulls out a sword or when he opens a door. So let's trigger it, and it doesn't have to be
Donkey Kong.
No, why don't we make it like Middle Eastern sounding and using those chord progressions and those different notes and melodies and sounds, even though they were bleeps and bloops. But and that was very different, and so. I won Best Music of the Year award that year, so they decided to make me the music guy.
Are the music guy. And the event coming to Casulas Arena in San Bernardino at Cal State San Bernardino, of course, is the Video Games Live Bonus Round, the number one touring game concert coming to Cal State San Bernardino, created and produced by our guest today, Tommy Tallarico.
And you had no formal training whatsoever, right? This is all by ear and what you've picked up in your environment?
That's right, yeah. The only formal training was in the streets, yeah. Sometimes that's the best. That's right. Yeah, no, but I never took lessons. I just always played by ear. So when people say, who did you study under? I'll say, Beethoven, Mozart.
There you go.
John Williams.
Because
that's what I would listen to. So I'd listen to Beethoven's Ninth Symphony, for example. And I would listen to all the different instruments and kind of figure out what they were all doing one at a time. Mm-hmm. And I'd figure it out on the piano and play it back. And that's kind of how I learned to write music for an orchestra, was just by listening. And then, of course, when computers, and now everything's computerized, so I can literally have an entire orchestra right on my laptop and with a little, piano keyboard hooked up to it. I can have any sound in the symphony.
Fantastic.
So you can literally... go through and write everything. So
now
yeah.
This Video Games Live has been going on since, can you explain a little bit about it? 6 years now?
Yeah, we've been touring on the road for over 6 years now. We recently had our 200th show down here at the Nokia Theater in LA during the big E3. It's the big industry event. I started the company in 2002, and then in 2005 is when we had our first show at the Hollywood Bowl. The first show ever was at the Hollywood Bowl. Everybody thought we were completely insane.
To choose the Hollywood Bowl?
I figured if I wanted to do the first show ever, I wanted it to be in the most famous venue in the world.
Why not?
With the LA Philharmonic, too, we did. We had over 200 musicians on stage. And no one had ever done anything to that magnitude, of course.
Were there naysayers?
Naysayers, everybody. I think I was the only one. I was the only one who thought it was a good idea. I mean, we couldn't. Even the video game companies were like, "Are you crazy? What are you talking?
Wow.
You want the music to Final Fantasy for what reason?
Right.
You
want
to play it live? Right. Who's going to come to that? Because the thing is, my whole approach was, I wanted to make the symphony for everybody. It doesn't just have to be for a certain generation of folks, but I took all of the things that I grew up on, video games and video screens and rock and roll lighting and interactivity and live action and all those things that my generation and younger grew up on.
Right.
And I took that and I combined it with a traditional symphony, and it really is a show for everybody. You don't have to know anything at all about video games to come on out and really be able to follow along and appreciate it. In fact, those people are the ones who enjoy the show the most, because they're like, Oh my gosh, I had no idea. This is video game music?
And the beauty of this is you're going to be working with our own San Bernardino Symphony.
That's right.
The orchestra will be accompanying the game footage on a giant screens all over the casino.
Giant, three big screens. And the great thing, the reason we call this bonus round is because it's, you know, this show that we're doing in San Bernardino is, like, it's very unique than all the other shows we do. So every time we play, and when we come to an area for the first time, we've never played San Bernardino before,
right,
we put a whole new show together, so it's all new material. So even if folks who came to the LA show in the earlier summertime, this show completely different,
so it's worth seeing both.
You got to see it both for sure. That's and we have a bunch of special guests as well, because there's so many game composers in the LA area,
right?
So I mean, we have, you know, we're going to be doing this big God of War thing, and the composer of God of War is going to be a special guest conductor.
Oh, fantastic.
Our friends from Blizzard Entertainment, who are in Orange County, we have the composer who's coming out and conducting some special pieces that have never been done before. BioShock, a big popular game, that composer is going to come out and guest conduct his music. So we have a bunch of stuff. We do new stuff, we do old stuff, we'll be doing games like Street Fighter and Chrono Cross and Final Fantasy.
And Guitar Hero?
Zelda. We have an interactive Guitar Hero segment.
Okay.
So what we do is before the show, people can come before the show and play Guitar Hero.
Ooh.
And whoever gets the highest score, we're going to bring them on stage during the show.
Ooh.
They're going to play Guitar Hero on the big screen. The San Bernardino Symphony is going to play along with them. I'm going to be playing live guitar along with them.
Great.
And they have to score a certain amount of points to win a big prize. So if you can imagine, you know, a person on stage playing this with the symphony playing along, the crowd cheering them.
Yeah.
I mean, they really do become a Guitar Hero for those, you know, 4 or 5 minutes.
So this is for gamers, non-gamers, symphony lovers.
It's
people new to gaming?
Brand new to gaming, absolutely. Because, again, you know, I think that's the most shocking thing.
Mm-hmm.
The best letters and emails that we'll get after a show are from the non-gamers.
Really?
You know, the mom who brought the neighborhood kids.
Right.
Or the grandparent who brought the grandson to the symphony for the first time. Or maybe the girlfriend who got this for the boyfriend.
Yeah.
But she likes the symphony. They're the most amazing letters that we'll get is from those folks. Because let's face it, the gamers, we know how great the music to Warcraft and Final Fantasy and Halo are. We already know this. You know, so to see it live is something special. But that wow factor really comes into play for the folks who've never seen it before. And you know, the other great thing is that we'll get letters from parents where they'll say, you know, I brought my 8-year-old daughter to the show last night, and we were all sitting around the breakfast table talking about it. I was so blown away. But I just wanted to write you to let you know, my 8-year-old daughter said, Mom, I want to start taking violin lessons so I can learn the music to Zelda, or the music to Mario, and this and that. So just like John Williams and
did for you
pop
Star
culture
Wars,
and
right?
Star Wars,
right.
Pop culture had that effect on me when I was 10. Well, now video games are getting younger kids involved and interested in the arts. And that's the beauty of video
Introduce them to symphonic music.
That's the beauty
Tell
of it.
Tell us about, you know, we hear so much about gang activity, but you have a different
in a positive
kind of
way.
Gang, as in G-A-N-G, which Tommy stands for.
It's a nonprofit organization I started 10 years ago. It's called the Game Audio Network Guild.
Okay.
The moniker of a gang.
Uh-huh.
So we say, come and be a gang member. And I set that up. We have over 2,000 members worldwide, representing 28 countries around the world. And it's basically a place where for people who are interested in getting into the video game industry to do music or audio
or
voiceover work. Not design, just for audio.
Okay, just
this
the audio
one, just
aspect.
For audio.
Gotcha.
So if you're interested in getting involved.
Including voiceover work?
Voiceover work. Maybe you'd like be a gang member.
Yeah.
You fly your colors.
Why not?
Yeah, we got special signs too. We'll teach
Love
you
it.
Secret
Love
handshakes,
it.
The whole thing. No, but if you... If you check out the website, audiogang.org, if anyone's interested in getting into the game audio industry. Now, if folks are interested to get into the gaming world, anyway, I mean, there's so many jobs. There's arts, there's programming, there's production, design, marketing,
right.
PR,
right.
You name it, there's a job out there probably, you know, in the video game world for it.
What would you say to a young person, because now they offer
in
college degrees
that's right.
in video game design.
UCLA, USC,
yeah.
They have great
yeah.
programs.
They're coming out of school, they want their yeah. first job. What would you suggest they do?
Well, you have to go to, there's a great website out there called GammaSutra.com.
Okay.
And you'll find a bunch of amazing information on there. The video game industry, like most industries, but video game industry for sure, it's all about networking.
Right.
You know?
Right.
Talent is half of it.
Mm-hmm.
So many times people put too much into 100%, they work on the talent aspect.
Right.
I split it up 50-50. You know, mm-hmm. 50% is talent, but the other 50% is knowing the right person.
Well, you said it.
Selling yourself.
Networking.
Right, that is right. just as important. And if people spend as much time, if students spend as much time on networking as they did on honing their craft, they'd get a lot farther. So in that regards, the Game Developers Conference happens every year in San Francisco.
Mm-hmm.
GDCconf.com is the website. It happens in March every year, and that's where 15,000 game designers from all over the world will get together. You'll learn more in 4 days and meet more people there in 4 days than you would anywhere else in the world.
Shake hands, meet and greet.
That's the deal, right? And so, and there's also local organizations, the International Game Developers Association, IGDA.org, they're a nonprofit as well. So they have little gatherings once a month. And so if some folks here from the Inland Empire, mm-hmm. you know, I think they have I know they have an Orange County one, I know they have an LA one,
mm-hmm.
they may have one for this area. If not, go to the LA one, that's the biggest one anyway.
Sure.
And so it's all game designers and people in the gaming industry get together to hang out once a month. And this is the way to get into the video game industry, you know?
And if people are maybe concerned, well, financially, how am I gonna do this? Now they're granting grants. The National Endowment for the Arts is actually a U.S. agency, federal agency, granting money for these people, these students,
right.
trying to get into it. And I mean, they're providing financial support for creative ideas.
Yeah, and the great thing is that, you know, with games now, it's kind of like the old days. When I first got in the industry, four or five guys could be in a room or a garage and you could make a video game. And then in the 90s and 21st century,
mm-hmm.
it's like for the big games, the PlayStation 3 games, Xbox, you have like teams of 200-300 people. But now because of all the iPhones and the Androids and the
mm-hmm.
you know, Xbox Live arcade games and things
mm-hmm.
like that, you can now have 2-3 people teams now again and putting your products out there. So it's, we've seen it come full circle. So you don't need $30 million to make a video game anymore. A couple of friends, if they have an idea and they get the, you know, the software program, you can put a game out there for, you know, a couple $1,000.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, that's incredible.
Yeah.
So it's what's old is new again.
That's right. Exactly. Going back retro. Yep.
Wow, that's fantastic.
Yeah. And that's where some of the best ideas come from is from those.
Where, Tommy, what do you really want people to take away from this program when they come out to Cal State October 29th?
Mm-hmm.
It's at the Casulas Arena. A big venue. What do you want people to really come away with?
Yeah, I mean, picture this. I mean, I like to describe Video Games Live as having all of the excitement and energy of a rock concert.
Cool.
Mixed together with all the cutting-edge visuals and interactivity and technology and fun that video games provide.
Mm-hmm.
Combined with, you know, the power and emotion of a symphony orchestra. So again, we created the show for everyone. And, you know, the goal was originally is I wanted to prove to the world
mm-hmm.
how culturally significant and artistic
mm-hmm.
video games have become.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the big goal, I think, is that, again, half the audience will be hardcore gamers and the other half don't know the difference between a God of War and a Tetris block. They have no clue, and we love that as well. So it really is, it's something like no one has ever seen before. It's interactive. We do interactive things with the audience. There's a
Let's talk a little bit more about that, because you mentioned Guitar Hero. That's
Guitar
interactive.
Hero's an interactive
What else
one.
Is interactive about this
I don't want to give away too much of the set list, but, okay, but you're okay. asking. And okay. So don't anyone say anything, okay? Just between the three of us. We're going to do something where I'm going to pull somebody out of the audience.
Uh-huh.
And they're going to come up on stage, and they're going to play an interactive game of, we'll play like something like Space Invaders.
Okay.
So all, but they are the ship from Space Invaders. So the orchestra plays the music, John, and it gets faster and faster and faster, mm-hmm. and they have to run around, because they're the ship, so we track them on stage. And so they'll run around on stage, and we give them a button to shoot. And so they're
These are like laser
shoot.
Type things going on?
Yeah, exactly, yeah. Wow. exactly. So, so things like that. Cool? Got things like that. We have some very special guests too that are going to blow people's minds. And you can expect to see a lot of stuff there, like, you know, Zelda's 25th anniversary is this year.
Has it been 25 years?
25 years since the first Zelda. So you'll see things like Halo and a lot of Blizzard stuff with Warcraft.
Tommy, what is the biggest game going right now? And I know that can change in another month.
I was going to say, what time is it?
It can change in 20 minutes,
It's
going to
change
right?
in 20 minutes. No, the Call of Duty stuff, people are playing massive amounts of that. You know, World of Warcraft, still, 12.5 million users a month.
Wow.
Playing that. You know, the new Zelda came out for the 3DS. I know that's at the top of the charts always. So there really is stuff out there for everyone, no matter what system you have, whether it's play. I mean, games like Uncharted 2 and Red Dead Redemption from last year, people are still playing that a lot and talking about it. So L.A. Noire was another game that recently come out that a lot of people are playing right now. Everybody's looking forward to Uncharted 3, which is coming out later this year.
Games are almost like films, aren't they? I mean, you start
better than
to look,
films.
You start to look forward to it because you can actually participate.
That's right. Well, it's interesting. You know, when a new game comes out, people will be lined up at Best Buy or
really?
Electronic or ED Games or whatever, GameStop.
Yeah.
The night before.
Wow.
Yeah, the night before. Wow. So just like people used to do with films or concerts,
exactly.
People are lining up by the thousands to get the be there at midnight when they open the store. And
Tommy, before we wrap up, is it true that older people should play games because it can ward off dementia and old age, that it's good for the brain?
We'll go with that.
It makes a lot of sense to me.
Yeah, well, I tell you, it's great. Nintendo did a fantastic job of getting a lot of non-gamers to go out and buy systems when they came out with the Wii. My mom bought a Wii, and she plays the Wii Fit.
Yeah.
She does it every day religiously.
Which is the exercise.
It's like the exercise thing.
Bowling, the whole thing.
It's got bowling.
Yeah, I've done that.
The Wii comes with that. But the Wii Fit is a great thing. So, yeah, there's a lot of great games out there. Games get a bad rap. They're so violent and this and that. It's there's a great website out there. If people are concerned or, looking to find out more information about the video game industry, great website called theeca.com.
What does ECA stand for?
What the heck is it? The Electronic Consumer Association. I don't know.
Okay, probably Electronic Consumer Association.
Something like that. Yeah, Now I'm on the spot. Yeah. They're going to kill me. But ECA.com, and it has an industry facts thing, and you can find all the industry. Okay, most games are not mature rated, like 90% are not. The average person who plays a video game, 30 years old.
Really? Okay.
30 years
old. Okay.
Between 30, 35 years old. It changes it from
year
to year.
Are you a gamer?
I have a Wii.
You have a Wii?
Okay.
Sounds like a gamer to me.
There is a PlayStation in my house and everything. But
and on your phone, you probably have some games going
Angry
on
Birds,
there. Angry Birds.
Like
that's a video game. Tetris, but whatever it is, it's gaming.
What's also exciting, too, is not to mention the video games live at Cal State, the event. There's going to have a pre-show, and they're going to be trick-or-treating, and there's also a meet-and-greet
as
well.
It's 2 days before Halloween.
We're going to have a costume contest. So come dressed as your favorite video game character. We're going to bring everybody up on stage. Whoever comes in a costume is going to come up on stage before the show starts. And we're going to let the audience decide on who wins the best prize for costume.
Tickets are on sale right now. It's at the Casulas Arena, California State University, San Bernardino. It's Video Games Live. It is the Touring Game Concert, and it's the bonus round, as Tommy Tallarico has pointed out. He's the inventor of this entire show, and he's partnered with the San Bernardino Symphony on this show. Saturday, October 29th, it's coming up just a few days away. Pre-show at 6 o'clock, the show at 7:30. SanBerninoSymphony.org, www.SanBerninoSymphony.org. You can also go to www.Ticketmaster.com. Get your tickets today, because this is going to be a sold-out event, and that is absolutely for sure. Cash, credit card, Visa, MasterCard. There will be a slight charge for parking. Parking is free if you have a CSUSB parking permit.
And after the show, we're going to have a meet and greet with all the famous game composers from around the area.
People can shake their hands and get autographs.
We're probably going to have about 15, 20 different game composers from all over the world, and it's part of the ticket. So it's no.
Fantastic.
Just come on in and come on afterwards and meet everyone. And
once again, go to Ticketmaster.com and check it out. It's the 29th at the Casulas Arena, csusb.edu. You can get more information, 909-537-7360. Man, this is an exciting event. I hope that you will be returning with this show next year.
Every year, if people come out this time, we'll come back next time with a whole new show.
Now keep in mind, the first time he did this at the Hollywood Bowl, people said, you're gonna have 2,000 people. How many actually showed up?
Oh, over 11,000 people showed up.
All right, there you go. Casulas is gonna be screaming on the 29th, and be sure to wear your favorite gamer costume. Tommy, thanks a lot for being on the show. Good to have you here.
Appreciate it.
It's going to be very, very successful. We'll be back with more Inland Empire Live right after these short messages. Stay tuned.